All right. So it can be broken down into simple ingredients: moisture, instability, lift. Ooh, this is easy, right? We just have to figure out how much moisture we have, how unstable is it, and how much vertical motion or lift there's going to be. Well, sounds very straightforward, but we really can't measure lift or vertical motion very well. We don't observe it until we see clouds. How much instability? Well, we have soundings twice a day. Models give us instability. Is it correct? Maybe. Maybe not. And how much moisture is there? Well, we have a lot of surface obs. How much information do we have about moisture above the ground? Not very much, really. So, how well do we observe the current state of the atmosphere? How well do we predict it? Let's look at some different observing systems and focus on how well we sample moisture. And the reason I'm going to focus on moisture is because obviously it is the key ingredient, one of the key ingredients in deep moist convection. And are we going to get thunderstorms? So here's a cartoon of different observational data sources from different types of satellites, radio sondes, aircraft, surface networks, et cetera, et cetera. One of the things that we have to recognize, all observing systems have strengths and limitations. Radio sondes, they give us really good vertical resolution, but pretty poor time resolution, typically only twice a day, and horizontal resolution isn't good. There's large gaps between the radio sondes. METAR sites, hey, we get high horizontal and time resolution, but no vertical. We know what the temperature and dew point is at the ground. Do we know how that goes up? What's the vertical profile look like immediately above that particular METAR site? We don't really know. What about VAD winds from the radars? Well, high time resolution, some better horizontal resolution given the radar network, but the vertical resolution depends on the scatterers. Sometimes we get a lot of data up to 5, 6, 7 kilometers. Sometimes it only goes up to 1. Or maybe 2, and that's kind of insufficient. And we obviously don't get any thermodynamic data. What about wind profilers? Uh-oh, we used to have a bunch of those, and they aren't funded anymore. And they haven't been funded for several years. So we've actually lost some data sources, especially across the middle of the country. GPS satellite, well, we can get high time resolution, variable horizontal, but really poor vertical resolution. The satellite data is not very good in the vertical, and we get integrated precipitable water. Well, that is pretty useful, but how do you take 1.5 inches of PW through a deep column and partition it in the vertical? How much is in the low levels? How much is in the mid levels? Do we know? We don't know from that information. So we have some limitations. What about the satellite retrievals, whether they be from geostationary or polar? Again, it's low vertical resolution. And especially for severe weather forecasting, we really need the information in terms of the vertical profiles. And when we look at the sounder on the GOES satellite, even though we have GOES 16 up there, we don't have a hyperspectral sounder. It's still impacted by clouds and precipitation. Ah, but you say, we've got a ton of aircraft data. And that's true. We get a lot of temperature and wind data, especially at the cruise altitudes. But most of them don't have water vapor sensing systems on them because they're expensive. Airlines didn't want to put them on there. And as a result, we don't have as much moisture data from the aircraft as we would like to have. And then if you have bad weather, you have thunderstorms affecting airports, what are the planes doing? They're not going up and they're not coming down where you want them. So when you have interesting weather, you might not have the data. So we've got a lot of different platforms and sensors that if you combine them intelligently, we can get a more complete view of what the atmosphere looks like. But there's still gaps in our ability to sample what's the pre-convective environment looks like before storms develop, and then after storms develop what we call the near-storm environment. Storms embedded within a certain environment, what's it moving into? How is that going to impact the storm evolution? We don't really observe the four-dimensional distribution of water vapor as well as we need to. So what we have found is that we still have to apply traditional analysis techniques with the available observational data if we want to work at short-term severe weather forecasting. So let's look at this. The relationship between severe events and their environments, whether it be synoptic or mesoscale. This has been a long history of doing research that would say, we had a tornado outbreak. What did the atmosphere look like leading up to that and during that particular event? And we want to link the events with environments, both pattern and parameters, to gain a sense of what types of environments support severe weather. And chart analysis has been a traditional component of this, and it has been useful in doing things like creating conceptual models. Here's an idealized tornado outbreak pattern in the middle of the country, southerly low-level jet, southwesterly upper-level jet, perhaps a subtropical, within the warm sector, maybe near the warm front, ahead of the cold front. That's pretty common knowledge. Does it mean every time we get a pattern like that, we get a tornado outbreak? Not necessarily. Depends on a lot of other factors. But this is something that has come about through a long period of study, and this is how come we can recognize with a particular pattern, with the right environment, there's potential for what we could say is more interesting severe weather to occur. Here's an example from Palm Sunday, way back in 1965. A lot of tornadoes in the Great Lakes, a lot of fatalities. This was a very seminal paper by Fujita and Bradbury and Van Thulener. Came out in the January 70 issue of Monthly Weather Review, and it was about 50 pages or so. I mean, it was a really long paper. And they did a very, very detailed study, but they included a lot of chart analysis to set the stage. Charts on the left from the morning of the outbreak, and then at 0Z, 12 hours later, they did chart analysis at different levels. They did surface analysis, including different air mass types in through there. April 3rd, 74, another major outbreak. This was a more recent paper that Steve Corfitti took the lead on from SPC. And what was in this particular paper, which is, you'll probably say, is somewhat unusual, is hand analysis charts that were published in the article. This is 12Z the morning. And you can see the strong jet coming in from the west coast at 250, diffluent pattern over the east. This is the 500 millibar chart, temperatures, heights. This is the 700 millibar chart. This is the 850 chart with the moisture showing up in the eastern part of the country. And if you look at these starting at 12Z the day before, these are all the 12Z at April 2nd. Upper left 850, 700 upper right, 500 lower left, 250 in the lower right, and then track these at 12-hour intervals. You can see the jets moving east, you can see the 500 trough moving east, you can see the moisture beginning to develop at 850, this is at 12Z in the morning, this is at 0Z during the peak of the outbreak, and then 12Z the next morning. So you can actually see the sequence of events as the systems develop and progress eastward just by doing the chart analysis. And also surface analysis, we'll talk more about this on Wednesday. So, philosophy. We plot constant pressure level charts twice a day at the mandatory levels. And we've been able to supplement the RAOB data with at least the VAD winds we used to be able to put the profiler winds on. And one of the things that has been stressed is they want to be able to identify patterns, features, and trends that can impact storm development. What's the flow aloft? Are there features that might generate upward vertical motion on the larger scale that can be useful over a period of time of modifying the air mass, steepening lapse rates? What's the thermal and moisture distribution? And where are the wind maxima in terms of, say, jet streams, so that we can identify upper-level divergence, lower-level convergence regions, apply the continuity equation in a pretty straightforward form, and see where there might be pronounced areas of upward motion. Now, some folks have said if you're doing an upper air chart, focus on that data alone. I don't want you looking at anything else. I don't buy that. I want everything I can get my hands on to help me do a better analysis. So I'm going to look at satellite loops in real time. How did we come up to the present time? Where are there short waves? Where is there increase in vertical motion? I'm going to look at satellite loops to help me understand the structure of the atmosphere. I'm going to look at model analyses and forecasts. I'm not shy about that. What are they saying it should look like? I'm looking for hints. And I'll look at our objective analyses on the SPC webpage. I don't see anything wrong with utilizing other data sources to help you do a better job of analysis. We should be integrating information from a variety of sources, but we should allow the observed data to determine the analysis. We have to pay great attention to that data and make sure that we are not ignoring any details. And sometimes you will see, especially in the RAYOBS, because they're relatively far apart, some data that may look a bit unusual initially. You'll say, well, gosh, that's not fitting my analysis. Well, maybe there's something special going on in that area, and it just happens to be sampling it. So in those situations, look at the sounding. Compare it to the previous upper air chart. Make sure the data are for certain wrong. There's errors in it before you toss it out, because it could indicate something important happening. So here's the general plotting model. You'll see this in some charts. You've seen it before. Height, temperature, dew point on the left. And then we look at the changes. 12-hour height change, 12-hour temperature change, 12-hour dew point change. Height change is important. We know from a variety of QG equations, if heights are falling, what's happening? Something's taking place. Either there's warm, cold advection beneath the trough, immediately beneath it, thermal advection. Things are happening that influence vertical motion, and those height changes can be important to recognize. And the temperature and dew point changes, are we warming, are we moistening, or are we not? What does that mean for stabilization, destabilization? These are things to pay attention to, even on the broad scale. So we're looking for features that will give us information about vertical motion, as well as areas of thermodynamic support for thunderstorm activity. Well, you may ask, we've got all this advanced data assimilation into NWP. It's looking at all sorts of data that we can't really process well. Why do we still have to do manual analysis? Is it really necessary? Because the models have more data than we do to work with. Not only are they looking at RAYOBS, but at VAD winds as well, satellite radiances, PWs, atmospheric motion winds, vectors, aircraft data. Why should we be doing our own analysis? It takes time, it takes work. Believe me, it takes practice to get good at it. So why are we doing it? Well, one of the things that we have to think about is, what's the primary goal of models? Models is to produce the best forecast possible. They're worried about what's going to be happening 12, 24, 36, 48 hours down the road. That's what the main goal of the models are. And they fine-tune, they alter the data assimilation schemes in order to improve the verification scores of the forecast. So what this means is you sometimes loosen the fit to the actual data, and you actually get a better model forecast. So the best initial conditions for a model may not be the same as the best analysis for a forecaster to use to figure out what's happening here and now. So again, as I said, the forecast skill has traditionally been found to improve when the initial fit to RAYOB data is loosened. So model initial analyses, or what some people call the zero-hour forecasts, can have errors that are built in. Now, the fit to data tends to be better than it used to be, but there's still differences between observed data and model initial conditions. Do you need to make a change in the recording at all? Whoops. Nah, doesn't look like it. So let's look at some zero-hour analysis and ray-off differences for the RAP, the NAM, and the GFS-3 operational models. This is for the first 7 months of last year. Some of the data after July was not good. So what we're looking at here is just the model analysis compared to ray-offs at zero Z, and we're looking at height errors. And then at the top is root mean square errors. And one of the things that we're seeing for the three models is once you get above 700 millibars, we're probably talking about 8 to 10 meters or more difference between the ray-ob and what the model is saying is there. And if we look at the bias at the bottom, they all tend to have a negative height bias, somewhere, you know, averaging around 3 to 5 meters. But it doesn't fit exactly with what is on the ray-ob. Let's take another parameter. Let's look at relative humidity. And in the upper graph, that's root mean square error again, we tend to see errors of 10% or greater of a difference between what the model has at the 0 hour time at the ray-ob site and what the ray-ob has. So we're not seeing exactly what the ray-ob has. And in some instances, the difference can be somewhat larger. So the model analysis may not be the way you would analyze the data if you were doing an upper air chart. Here's some examples. This is a case from September of 14, but things haven't changed much. This is a RAP 850 millibar dew point analysis, the green lines, and there's squiggles all over the place. And then we've got 850 dew points showing up at some of the stations, and hopefully you can see those pretty well. And if you start to look closely, look down here, 17 degree dew point at Brownsville. Well, this is a 14 line. The 16 might be just south of Brownsville, but it certainly didn't come up very far. Where else? Well, let's look over here. We have a tight gradient. Here's a 10 degree dew point at Greensboro. Well, it's not too bad. It's somewhere between 8 and 10, but then it has this 8 line pumping up somewhere into Virginia, although we don't know exactly why because there's no data sitting there. There's also a 15 degree dew point here, and we don't even have a 14 isodrosotherm analyzed at Charleston. What about in this area? Well, we got a 7 at Wilmington, we've got a 7 at Nashville, and somehow it's putting a 10 line in the Midland, Kentucky. Where'd that come from? I don't know. I mean, it's using other data sources, but I don't know. What about here? We've got a 10 at Davenport, an 11 at Minneapolis, and here's this less than 8 tongue coming on down between a 10, a 10, and an 11. Where'd that come from? Do we really have this dry air in here? I don't know. But the RAP says we do. What about out here? We're missing Aberdeen, which is up in northeast South Dakota, but here's this whole area 12. There's no data supporting it, but it's showing up in the model initial time. We can find this all over the place. Oh, a couple of little areas less than 10. Well, there's no data. Here's another one, less than 10, just through western Kansas, but there's a 10 at Dodge. Where'd this plus 12 come from? It's a little detail. Is it right? Maybe. Maybe not. Oh, there's another min, less than 8, around Fort Smith. How about this one? It's a plus of 14, just west of Midland's 13. Oh, there's a couple of others down there in South Texas, little 14s. Less than 12. I don't know what's going on in the Gulf. And I certainly don't know what's going on with that high amplitude sinusoidal wave pattern in the dew point out over the Atlantic. So this is what the model is starting out with. And it's not clear how good it might be. What about the NAM? Well, here's the NAM. If we go back and forth between them, well, there's differences in the details. Is one of them better than the other? Do we have any idea? Not really. It gets kind of tough to figure out what's going on with the models right at the start time.